ESPN College Football. Tonight, we're at Jones C. Edwards Stadium in Huntington, West Virginia for a Conference USA matchup between the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers and the Marshall Thundering Herd. 2 years ago on this field, oh, tempers flared in the pregame warm-ups when these teams met in Huntington. Then Western Kentucky shocked unbeaten Marshall 67-66 in overtime, knocking the Herd out of a major bowl bid, and a rivalry was born. Good evening and welcome to Huntington. Along with John Gregory, I'm Bill Roth. For the third year in a row, the Thundering Herd and the Hilltoppers wrap up the regular season. And as usual, a lot is on the line.
Yeah, and it's an important game for both of these teams. Last game of the year. But for Western Kentucky this year, with a win, they can host the conference championship next week. So the rivalry is even more important for Western Kentucky tonight.
And boy, does Western Kentucky have an offense as usual under Coach Jeff Fromm. The Hilltoppers, one of the highest scoring teams around, led by this guy, a terrific quarterback from Florida.
Yeah, Mike White, Coach Brian Brohm, the quarterback coach, was really surprised on his knowledge of this offense and how he's performed this year. Great mechanics, very accurate with the football, and probably the biggest thing that these receivers like, he throws a very catchable football.
Touchdown. Western Kentucky has two of the most prolific receivers around, and Taywan Taylor and Nicholas Norris.
Yeah, wow. Look at their numbers. Both of these guys over 1,000 yards this year. Taywan Taylor, he had a single season record last year, and he's on pace to beat that this year. Nick Norris, 7 catches against Marshall last year. He's averaging 16 yards every time he catches the football. He's got 12 touchdowns on the year. Two prolific receivers.
Now we've got some breaking news on the Marshall sideline. A change in quarterback. A young true freshman from South Georgia, Garrett Morrell, will start tonight at QB for the Herd.
Yeah, he made a start against Louisville earlier this year, and kind of a surprise start for him here. And there's some problems with Chase Litton's shoulder. And the difference between these two guys, according to Bill Legg, the offensive coordinator, really is just difference in experience. So if he can have an effective day today spreading the football around, Marshall is going to have to try to throw it down the field to compete with this Western Kentucky team.
Well, and what is on the line here tonight? Well, if Western Kentucky wins this game tonight, they'll advance to the Conference USA Championship game and will host it next week in Bowling Green. If Marshall wins tonight, then it is Old Dominion that will win the division, as the Monarchs won today. Here's the kickoff from Amaretto Curry to the Hilltoppers, and we are underway, and a fake reverse on the kick return. And here comes Towson down the left sideline. What a way to start it for Western Kentucky on the road, and it is an opening touchdown return. And just like that, the Hilltoppers strike first. Kylan Towner faked the reverse and takes it the distance, and Western Kentucky gets on the board to begin the game.
Now this Western Kentucky team has scored now on 8 of 9 football games on their first possession. I don't even call this a possession, an opening kickoff right now, and able to get this in for the quick score. And for Marshall, they've been giving up scores early in football games. And Western Kentucky, with an off week, comes out with a little surprise with the fake reverse.
93 yards on the return for Kylan Towner. And the extra point is good. And just like that, Western Kentucky takes a 7-0 lead. They're a big favorite coming into this game tonight. And clearly, that's the exact thing that Marshall wanted to prevent. They wanted to try to get off to a good start tonight. Instead, the opposite has happened.
And that's exactly the start that Western Kentucky wanted coming in here. Coach Brohm, we talked with him earlier the week. That's what this offense, that's what this team is built around, quick score, and they get out to a good lead, and they've got such a great defense. They've been able to hold people down all year when they're trying to play catch-up.
They won the conference a year ago. They've won 5 straight games coming into our ball game here tonight. And with a win this evening, they'll host the championship game. On the other side, it's been an outlier of a season for the Marshall team and Coach Doc Holliday. Over the years, Marshall's been one of the most consistent winners in Conference USA, but it has been an arduous season for the Thundering Herd.
Now, in talking with Doc Holliday, he told us he can never remember in his entire career ever having a year like this as far as wins and losses, but the injuries and everything else that's piled up around this football team. So he was hoping his team could get off to a great start tonight, especially on when you talk about special teams.
So 14 seconds in, it is 7-0 for the Tops, and now the Thundering Herd will get the ball for the first time. Alex Ranella with the boot
And Rodgers running it back for the herd. And shy of the 23-yard line, he gets knocked down there by Marshall. Well, here is Garrett Morrell, the freshman from Leesburg, Georgia. It's his second start. He did start earlier in the year, very early, as a matter of fact, against Louisville for Marshall University. But this is different. We're now towards the end of November. He's been through this entire season learning and practicing. And Morrell will get his second start here tonight.
Yeah, a little bit more difficult during his first start. When Louisville came into this stadium here, he had that start that week. So he's got an opportunity to play in a few more games since that time. Got a little bit more comfortable with the offense. And the nice thing is he learned earlier in the week that there was going to be an opportunity possibly for him to start tonight.
Marshall trailing 7-0, and Morrell gets a quick pass to the left. We expect to see a lot of that here tonight. Short passes for the freshman, and that makes sense for Bill Legg and the Marshall offense to try to keep things simple against a much improved Western Kentucky defense.
Yeah, you want to try to keep things simple for this guy, but you also know that you're going to have to try to outscore Western Kentucky. So throwing the ball down the field and trying to spread them out may be your only opportunity tonight.
Out of the pistol, first carry of the night for Anderson running right. Bryant makes the tackle on the Minnesota native. And it'll be a third down and long now for Morrell.
And this has been the problem with this Marshall offense all year, is converting on third down. And it's the problem starts on first down, not being able to run the football. And they've really put them in third and long situations. And that's where they've gotten behind the chains.
Play signaled in from the sideline. One of the things that the Marshall coaches were very impressed with Morrell was his ability to run every play, because early in the season when he started against Louisville, they shortened the playbook. Not the case tonight. And now we've got flags before the play. In the first game, it was only his third game of his career, and so he didn't have the entire playbook at his disposal. Coach Holliday says tonight he's got the whole playbook at his disposal.
Yeah, and that's a lot easier when you talk about practice and how things move. And then you get into a game situation, things tend to speed up a little bit for the young guy. And there he takes a delay of game penalty early, so, and it backs Marshall up a little bit more.
And flags again before the play. Marshall's been a very, very highly penalized team. In fact, they're one of the most penalized team in college football. Now they're behind the sticks even more. And it's going to be third down and 19 now. Not the place you want to be when you're a true freshman QB. Morrell dumps it off short. Anderson breaks one tackle, and the topper is bringing down near the 25-yard line. And the Western Kentucky defense will force a punt as Gardner came in to make the play defensively.
Well, we'll talk an awful lot tonight about this Western Kentucky defense. When you look at their numbers across the board and defensive scoring, rushing, total yards, they're number one, number two in every category. So Marshall tonight is going to have to find a way to really do something that no one else has been able to do against this football team, and that's really try to get the ball down the field.
Towner calls for a fair catch, and after returning the opening kickoff for a touchdown, he takes a fair catch on the first punt. Western Kentucky gets the ball when we come back, leading on the road 7-0. Western Kentucky off to a quick start tonight on the road, hoping to host the Conference USA Championship game next week. It's been a frustrating beginning for Marshall on its home field.
That's a look at Cody Carter, the fifth-year senior, a local kid out of Cabell Midland High School, and introduced before this football game on his final night. And that's just not, you know, it's just frustration. That's not the way he wanted to start his senior night.
Mike White's first touch and the first offensive play of the game. And there is Wales running with the football, and he's knocked down by Neely of the herd. Wales is a terrific young man, senior out of Louisville. He's fourth in the country in scoring this season, and he rips off a 17-yard run on his first touch tonight. And we have a personal foul. We'll get another look at it. It's been a tough start for the Thundering Herd from a penalty standpoint as well. I think they got the wrong guy. That was actually Neely, the safety, that committed the penalty. But it has Western Kentucky in Marshall territory just 3+ minutes into the game. Same man running with the football, Ace Wales, the 50-year man. He's just one touchdown away from the school's touchdown record, brought down by Allen on the play. He's averaging nearly 7 yards a carry.
Yeah, over 1,000 yards on the year, 18 touchdowns, as you mentioned, and he's the one reason why this offense goes. You talk about the quarterbacks and the receivers, but they've got a really good running game, and it's been good over the last 4 games.
Another running play, and they're running behind that big offensive line, and Wales bursts this one to the right side, and he's belted out of bounds inside the 18-yard line. A good start for Wales. Kendall Grant delivered the hit, but Wales is off to a nice start on the road tonight.
Chuck Heater said that they need to have leverage on the outside. They need their linebackers, and you can see him bouncing to the outside. And you know, one of the things they want to do is just run the football. When they do that, that's just opening up things for Mike White. And this offensive line, as you said up front, can really protect him. A veteran group up front.
Wales this time falls down trying to cut it outside and knocked down on the play. Meanwhile, as you see behind the play, some pushing and shoving. It's been a frustrating beginning tonight for the Herd. No flags on the play. It'll be second down at about 13 coming up.
And we saw at the very top of this emotion, you know, senior night, last game of the year. Everybody wants to get the last shot in here, but for Western Kentucky, they have a chance to play for a championship, so they have to remain calm and composed and do what they need to do.
White going to put it up for the first time tonight. And he's got his man. That's Taylor. For the touchdown, it's Taywan Taylor. Does what he does great, seemingly every game. Another touchdown for the senior from Louisville. This young man holds just about every season and career passing record at Western Kentucky, and White's first throw of the night is a touchdown pass.
We mentioned the offensive line. Look at the time he has to throw the football, and you know, the coverage, Rodney Allen, one of the guys that are credited with for having probably the best year on the defensive side of the thing, playing way off that time. And you can't give Taylor that much room with White's connection and his ability and his accuracy. That was an easy throw for him.
Simcox knocks home his second successful PAT of the night. He's made all 52 on the year. Quick start for the Tops on the road tonight. Well, 2 years ago on this field, what a game. It started with a little pregame brawl between Western Kentucky and Marshall. This was an undefeated Thundering Herd team. Turned out to be one of the most memorable games in Conference USA history.
Yeah, it really was instant classic. And for Western Kentucky knocking Marshall off here at Jones C. Edwards Stadium in Huntington, that was a big thing for them. And that really created, I think, this rivalry. And Marshall had a chance to go to Western Kentucky last year and couldn't get it done there. So Western certainly got the better half of Marshall over this in 67-66. They went for two in overtime to win that football game. And that man right there, Doc Holliday, certainly talked to us about that last night.
Marshall will get the ball back now, trailing 14-0. Ranella kicks it to the Thundering Herd again. If Western Kentucky wins this game tonight, it'll host the conference title game next Saturday morning on its home field. Marshall will get the ball back after the kickoff return by Brandon Rogers. That was Drew Davis made the play defensively on the special teams. And Marshall will try to get it going again. If you're just joining us, a change at quarterback for Marshall tonight. Garrett Morrell starting in place of Chase Litton. Out with an apparent injury, and so Morrell, a rookie from South Georgia, will come in and get his second career start. He did start against Louisville earlier in the year. Western Kentucky, if there's one thing it's done a much better job of, is doing exactly that, stopping the run. A couple years ago, they were really struggling on the defensive side of the ball, and that's one area under defensive coordinator Nick Holt where the Hilltoppers have definitely improved.
Yeah, they'll put eight guys at the line of scrimmage and really say and dare you to try to throw the football. And this Russian defense is number 11 in the country, and they lead Conference USA. And I think a lot of that has to do with them getting out to such quick leads. Teams have to throw the ball against them, and they don't run as much. So that helps that statistic out.
Morrell going to put it up. Here comes the heat, and down he goes. First sack of the night in the 23rd of the year. That was Brown, the former Louisville Cardinal, who has come in and done a tremendous job for Coach Brohm and the Hilltoppers. One of two former Louisville Cardinals on defense, and one of three on the team. Brown gets his sixth sack.
Now he's a guy that's really led this football team, as you mentioned. He had 102 tackles coming into this ball game. You know, you get that 1 year and that transfer and you get an opportunity, he has really taken advantage of it.
And so now Morrell and the Herd behind the sticks again. Third and 12. Not the situation you want to be in. Already down two scores early on your home field. And another penalty. And that has the Natives restless. Looks like another delay.
Now, to me, when you look at that, you have that a couple times. You got a young quarterback in there, and he's looking over to the sidelines. You want to get things in quicker to him. He's got an opportunity. Don't give him too much to think about. Call a play, let him run it, and see if you can have some success with it. Give him an opportunity to play and not think so much.
Now third and 17, and the Hilltoppers play zone. Morrell throwing back across his body. Nice throw and a catch tonight, but it's going to be shy of the first down. Marshall will punt it away again. That was Gardner that made the play. Knight, the senior from Florida, with his first catch of the night, but another punting situation now for the Thundering Herd.
And for Western Kentucky, Marshall doing him a few favors right now with delay of game and some penalties that have backed him up and forced him into throwing situations. And Western Kentucky just playing back, allowing the throw underneath, knowing that they're going to come up a little bit short and punting it away.
Punt away from Vedvik. Towner calls for the fair catch again and takes it near the 28. And that's where the Hilltoppers will get the ball when we come back to Huntington. 14-0, Western Kentucky leading early. Be sure to kick off your Week 12 NFL Sunday with us on ESPN at 10 a.m. Eastern, NFL Insider Sunday Edition, with all the early breaking stories and injury news. Then at 11, Sunday NFL Countdown with Boomer, Trent Dilfer, Charles Woodson, Matt Hasselbeck, and the crew. Take you right up to kickoff, streaming live on the ESPN app, and watch ESPN. A flea flicker for Western Kentucky, and the throw is incomplete to the right side, and it will be second down. Well, the open day last week has allowed the Brohm family to come up with some creative stuff here early.
Yeah, I was thinking the same thing. That off week last week not only gave their players an opportunity to rest a little bit, and players throughout the week talked about that. They really needed it. They were a little banged up. So this gives them an opportunity to rest, and if they win tonight, be really fresh going into the championship game.
A rare miss for White on that play. This is flags thrown before the play, and this won't count. Very exciting. I'll tell you what, Western Kentucky puts on a show. Not only does it score a lot of points, as we know, but they do it in exciting ways, creative ways.
Yeah, talking with Chuck Heater last night, he was making a comment about Jeff Brohm, the head coach of this Western Kentucky team. He said, you know, he was a quarterback in his day, and he almost feels like he calls offensive plays like he's still playing quarterback. He wants to be a part of it and really feels like he is. And that's why he comes up with all these different types of gadgets.
Almost like he's playing the video game in front of his television, right? Except it's Mike White out there pulling the trigger. Another penalty on Marshall. It's been a penalty-filled first quarter for Doc Holliday's team. And that's frustrating, the seventh-year head coach of the Herd. Around the left end, there goes Wales. And he's knocked out of bounds near the 42-yard line. That was Allen that made the play defensively, but it'll be enough for another Hilltoppers first down. They already are up by two scores. And Allen has been, or rather, Wales has been the workhorse early. Their running game is going well. Here they go again. And Nicholas is finally pushed out of bounds inside the 30-yard line. White's on fire early. The Western Kentucky offense is clicking on all cylinders here in the first 8 minutes of this game.
Yeah, they've got all the tools they need. They've got the ability to stretch the field deep when you talk about Taylor on that side. And then Nick Norris, another guy, get him the ball in space and let him do what he does. He's got great speed, really shifty.
White on a play fake, looking deep. And he overthrows Norris this time, right side of the end zone. Western Kentucky averages 42 points a game, and you can see early they are putting up some big offensive numbers here on the road.
Well, what I like about their offense is the times they go down the field. We've already seen it numerous times in this football game, and if you watch last week's game against North Texas, they tried to match up man-to-man, and they just blew them out early in that football game.
Huge hole for Wales again, and he cuts it inside the 20 for another first down. That offensive line is getting it done tonight against a depleted Marshall defensive front. They put up some big yards, don't they?
Well, look at that. When you look at 500-yard games, Western Kentucky on top, there's some pretty good offense right there when you look at Baylor and Oregon. But Western Kentucky, they are starting to do it with balance. They were a team that, as we said before, throw it through the air quite a bit, get a lot of touchdowns, but they move the ball on the ground.
To the left side, there goes Wales again, and he ties the school record for touchdowns with that run from 19 yards away. It is all Western Kentucky on the road tonight here in Huntington. Anthony Wales, a tremendous touchdown run.
Now you can talk about his vision and everything else, but watch this offensive line up front. You've got guys pulling, a veteran group, 180 starts for this offensive line. They average about 3 years of starting experience, and they're all healthy, and that just opens up huge holes for Anthony Wales, and that time hardly touched before he went into the end zone.
He averages about 7 yards a touch on the year. He's over 10 yards per carry tonight. 9 minutes into the game, it is all Western Kentucky tonight on the road here in Huntington, West Virginia. It is the Hilltoppers 21 and the Herd nothing, thanks to that young man, Ace Wales. Well, a quick start on the road tonight for Western Kentucky. They know what's on the line, a win tonight, and they're hosting the CUSA championship game next week. And Jeff Grom's team off to a great start on the road this evening. And Ranella, the young man from Johnson City, Tennessee, will boot it to Marshall. The Thundering Herd needs some sort of a spark, maybe they can get it on special teams. And Neely gets it across to 30, but we do a flag on the play that'll bring this back. The kicker made the play, but a penalty marker thrown on the kick return. Boy, it's been all Western Kentucky so far. Here's the call first. Is this a perfect recipe for how to win on the road? From the opening kickoff, when Towns faked the reverse and took it to the house.
And good speed, too, as he gets to the outside here. He had one guy to beat in the kicker, and as you said before, just racing down for the touchdown.
Then White connects with his favorite target, Taylor. That made it 14-0 just 5 minutes into the game. And then Wales breaks a tackle at the line of scrimmage and makes it 21-0. Hilltoppers diving across with just under 6 minutes to go here in the first quarter. So let's see what Marshall could do in its final game of the season. First carry for Tony Pittman, and the senior at 228 ran into McCollum on the play. And Dawson Brents, he's the other transfer from Louisville on that defense for Coach Braun, who of course played at Louisville. But it's been an offensive show since Coach Braun took over at Bowling Green. What a tremendous success they've had. And the defending CUSA champs hope to repeat. Tony Pittman again on the carry. He's upended. Marshall still looking for a first down here, trailing by three touchdowns.
Well, they had some success on first down, and now it's third and manageable. Each drive they started off, and they've put their own self in a hole, but this time they've got an opportunity, and this team needs some type of confidence. And here's the first look at what we're going to see possibly tonight, and that's a Wildcat.
It's Hylik Foster. That'll be enough for the first down. And a big crowd roars for Marshall as they pick up the first down as Anderson runs ahead for three.
Well, we're not going to hand it off. Let's just decide to give it to our 250-pound running back that time. Need to pick up one or two, and that's an emotional lift, at least for the sidelines for a moment here, and the fans in this stadium as they finally were able to get that first down.
Well, you know, they've been playing behind the sticks because of some penalties early. Another short pass and a good connection to the left side.
I asked Bill Legg last night, if you're going to open it up, are you going to throw the football down the field to try to match what Western Kentucky's going to do? He said, yeah, we have to try to do that. We haven't seen Marshall had that do that yet in this football game, and you expect to see that, but he said, don't get me wrong, we're going to have to throw it out to the sideline and try to spread these guys out and keep them from stopping our run game.
Norrell is 4 for 4 early. He mishandles this snap, and down he goes back on the 25-yard line. That was E.A. Bootyway making the play defensively. I don't know if it was a bad snap or he had his eyes downfield and just mishandled it. He probably should have had that one, although potentially Pittman ran into him just as the ball got there. So again, the herd behind the sticks. It's 3rd and 13. And the Hilltoppers coming to get him. He's hit as he throws, and it ends up on the Western Kentucky sideline. We've got a flag in the secondary, though. Downfield thrown by the side judge across the way here at Huntington.
Marshall that time actually setting up a screen. Western Kentucky just rushing four. They got to Morrell quickly back there. He really didn't even have time to set up to throw the screen.
Boy, Marshall looking for a break any way he could get one. They were hoping, you could just sense, they were hoping for a defensive holding penalty there. Something to give them a break to spark them on their home field.
Now, after getting the first down in this football game, again, it was a mistake. That time a little high snap, but something that Morrell will tell you that he probably should have had. And because of that, again, it put him behind the chains, and Western Kentucky is able to get off the field.
Pounder calls for the fair catch again, and the Hilltoppers will start on the 34-yard line. Well, Coach Braun has done an amazing job. His brother now, of course, has come in. Brian Braun is offensive coordinator, and they have been prolific, as we've seen over the last few years. You can take a look at the yards per game since Jeff's been the head coach at Western Kentucky.
Boy, it's just, you know, when you combine that yards per game, you look at the balance that they have and the ability. Some of the numbers that they have are amazing. Since 2010, Western Kentucky's had a 100-yard rusher in 61 of 87 football games. About 70% of the time, this team has a 100-yard rusher. So it's not all about great quarterbacks and throwing the ball down the field. That's just part of the offense.
White's going to take a deep shot, and he overthrows his man at the 30-yard line. White's got a good arm, as you can tell. That time he just overthrew his man. We talked with him. I said, how much of this offense that you run at Western Kentucky is similar to what you did at Louisville when you played?
Yeah.
And he said, well, some of it, the base is the same.
Mm-hmm.
We ran at Louisville, but Brian played a couple of years in the CFL. He says, I've added a little Canadian flavor to our offense.
Yep, part of that is the run-pass options that he's brought to this team.
Here is Wales, his first catch of the night, and he's got a first down and a whole lot more. Oh, Wales is having a big night on the road in Huntington. Here come the Hilltoppers again. He was knocked down on that far sideline by Tyler. Marshall comes with some heat, and White connects. That's 21 more yards for Wales on the catch.
Now they just keep hammering at you. They first down, they're going to throw the ball down the field and back you up and then throw underneath to their backs and their quick guys and just outrace you. This team has a lot of yards after the catch.
White to the right side and yards after catch for Taylor, who slung out of bounds. This college football season, stream every game live on the ESPN app and on Watch ESPN. Download the app or visit watchespn.com. Mike White, the junior from Fort Lauderdale, and the Hilltoppers looking for more here, already leading by 3 scores on the road. And that'll be a first down carry. Baker, his first carry of the night. He may be a familiar name to Marshall fans. He's from nearby Ashland, Kentucky. In fact, a one-time Marshall commit who changed his mind and signed with Coach Brohm and the Hilltoppers. About a year ago, right about now, he flipped from Marshall to Western Kentucky.
Yeah, rumor has it he watched that football game and decided last year after that game that he was going to go to Western Kentucky.
That's Lucky Jackson. He's a redshirt freshman from Lexington with his first catch of the night. And Chris Jackson made the play defensively. Late in the first, Marshall looking for a turnover. It needs something to happen to get its crowd into it and get its confidence going here. But so far, Western Kentucky has dominated and has its foot on the pedal. White to the end zone and a leaping attempt for Taylor. And it is an incomplete pass. Delayed call by the side judge over there. Chris Jackson defended Taylor. And the officials are getting together, and now they overrule the side judge and call it a touchdown. It'll clearly be reviewed, but what a tremendous grab by Taylor.
Boy, the instincts he has, the ability to go up and catch the football, and how about that? To me, it looks like he had the football originally, but is the ball moving here? And maybe that's what the official saw. You could see the official was crawling over there. That may be an incomplete pass because he never maintain possession of that football.
Chris Jackson, the corner on that side, never gave up on the play. He kept trying to strip it.
And you can see the official was just following that play, going down, watching it very closely to see if Taylor was able to maintain possession of the football. Right there, everything looked good, but didn't complete really the catch. And for Marshall, they're hoping for a break here just to try to prevent Western Kentucky from getting in one more time. What a great throw by Mike White. He gives his guy an opportunity. When you have an athlete like Taylor, his ability to go up and catch the football, that's what it's all about. You know, he was recruited by Jeff Brohm out of high school. He was a basketball player. Brohm never even saw him play football. He watched him play basketball live and decided, hey, I want this guy. He's an athlete. Let's just sign him. And they did that. And they've had a lot of success because they've had him on this football team.
He caught his 38th touchdown of his career earlier tonight. He was closing in on 4,000 career yards. No wide receiver in the history of the Commonwealth of Kentucky at any school has caught more yards or more touchdowns than Taywan Taylor. Referee Dan Gautreaux will fill us in on this. The ruling on the field, as you see, was a touchdown. However, upon review, it looked like the defensive back Chris Jackson may have
stripped him of the ball before Taylor was able to complete the catch.
Yeah, Jackson stayed with it, as you said, had his hand on the football and kept pushing. And because of that, my guess is they overturned this.
He makes the catch initially, gets his feet in, but Jackson just keeps raking the ball, stripping it away, and then as Taylor goes down, the ball comes free.
Boy, Doc Holliday saying, just give us a break here. We need something to go on. He's almost got a smile on his face. And, you know, when we talked to him last night, you could just see the wear and tear this season and the toll it's taken on Doc Holliday.
They're used to winning here. 33 wins over the last 3 years, but this season has been a tough one for them. Got off to a 1-4 start, and then the injury bug really hit the Thunder and Herd. And tonight playing without its starting quarterback, Litton. Here's the call. Well, you called it right, partner. And that just gives Mike White another opportunity to throw the football. From the 16. It's been all Hilltoppers on the road so far here tonight. White to let it go. And it's another touchdown. Oh, he is on fire tonight. That time hooking up with Wales, delivering it beautifully in the back of the end zone. We are seeing a clinic put on tonight by Mike White, the junior from Fort Lauderdale, throwing darts tonight here in Huntington. That time it was Wales with the reception. And the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers have exploded on the road.
And that's an easy throw for Mike White. The play action fake that time held the linebacker, Devontre Tyler, up the middle linebacker. And when you have the open field like that with the defenders spread out on the hash, it's an easy throw for the quarterback and another easy score for Western Kentucky.
Well, White thought he had a touchdown pass to Taylor on the previous throw. This time, on the little post, Anthony Wales gets the touchdown on the very next play. 30 touchdowns on the season. He went 66 yards in 7 plays, and Mike White is making it look easy, isn't he?
He certainly is. I mean, he's got all the tools, the ability to do that, his accuracy. I mean, it's on the year, 67% coming into this football game, and I think that was the biggest surprise to Jeff Brohm and his coaches.
If the Hilltoppers win tonight, they'll clinch the division, and they'll host Louisiana Tech in the championship game next Saturday. That game would be played at Western Kentucky. The reason for that is Southern Miss yesterday. An impressive home win, a big win for the Golden Eagles on their home field. Knocked off Louisiana Tech. That was down in Hattiesburg. And as a result, Western Kentucky, if it wins this game, will host next week. It will be a busy weekend. They've got 6 high school football playoff games next weekend at Western Kentucky. All the terrific high school games in the Commonwealth of Kentucky. The state championships are being played at Western Kentucky Stadium. They want to add a 7th game to next weekend, which is a challenge for game operations people. Marshall gets the ball back late in this first quarter. And Neely gets to the 20. Knocked down on the 21-yard line, but under a minute to go here in this first quarter that has been dominated by Western Kentucky. I'm not quite sure how you host 7 football games in one stadium over the course of a weekend, but they're going to have it next weekend. Also next Saturday, in primetime, the ACC championship game. Clemson and Virginia Tech will meet in Orlando. The Hokies with a big win today over their in-state rival, Virginia, at Lane Stadium. And Coach Fuente, in his first season, will battle Clemson and Coach Sweeney next Saturday night. Under 30 seconds to go. Little screen. And nothing doing again. Boy, the Hilltopper defense has had the answer tonight. First catch by Josh Knight, the leading receiver on this Marshall team, late in this first quarter. Just about every completion that Morrell has been of that variety, though, the short throw.
Yeah, the short throw, you know, this is a kind of patchwork offensive line. They're missing the whole right side, so they don't want to put Morrell in danger back there with this defensive front because Western Kentucky can get after the quarterback, so they're really trying to be careful with them on the short throws.
Uh-oh, in traffic and nearly intercepted, ruled an incomplete pass. E.A. Bukniwe had both hands on it, a.k.a. Iggy, but when he hit the ground, the ball popped free for the sophomore from Bowling Green. It'll be third down now with 10 seconds to go here in this first quarter. Third and 10 and a deep ball and no one home down the left side.
Now that's one of the problems there when you work with a young quarterback, and that's Josh Knight, who broke off his route that time, came back to the sideline, and Morrell expected him to go deep that time, and you don't get a whole lot of work throughout the season. The backup quarterback gets very limited reps this week. Of course, Garrett knew he was going to get an opportunity to play, so he got more opportunity, and that's him talking with Bill Legg as they come off the football field there and discuss what went wrong on that route.
Should be the final play of the first quarter, a punt for the Norwegian punter Vedvik. And the first punt return of the night, and an opportunity down the left sideline. Towner nearly did it again. He returned the opening kickoff for a touchdown in this rivalry game, and it has been tremendous range of emotions. A frustrating first quarter for Marshall University and its fans, and an exhilarating opening period for Mike White. Western Kentucky up 28-0 after one. Well, tonight here in Huntington, Western Kentucky, led by that man, Mike White, scores a season-high 4 touchdowns in the opening quarter, and here they go again. Coming back to the near side on a screen to Norris, and the second quarter begins with another Western Kentucky touchdown. What a night for Mike White and the Hilltoppers on the road. That's a 25-yard touchdown to Nicholas Norris.
Well, I don't know what else you can say besides it just seems like Marshall has kind of nailed it in, really. It's no effort on their part defensively, and right now it's just easy pickings for this Western Kentucky football team, and there's nobody there. Marshall looking slow, not a whole lot of heart, not a whole lot of enthusiasm, and Western Kentucky taking advantage of it.
White has thrown 3 touchdowns already tonight. The extra point makes it 35-0. Started coming to the right side for Mike White. Then he flips it back to the left side to senior Nick Norris, who sprints into the end zone and makes it 35-0 for the Hilltoppers on this big night for Mike White. Jeff Rahm and his Western Kentucky Hilltoppers are 35-0 lead tonight. On the road, he's looking down at his checklist. Everything he's called tonight has come up just the way you designed it. Romello will kick the football back to the Thundering Herd. Marshall could use a special team spark, that's for sure. And not going to get it here. 35-0 is the score here early in the second quarter. Let's check in now with a studio update. Here's Brendan Fitzgerald.
Thank you, Bill. They are underway at Clemson in the Palmetto Bowl. And Clemson with the ball here in the first quarter. Deshaun Watson to Mike Williams. 34-yard touchdown. And the Tigers up 7-0 over on ESPN. Back to Bill and John.
All right, Brendan, thanks. Good ball game there on rivalry weekend. Clemson looking forward to its appearance next Saturday night down in Orlando. Morrell throws it to the right side and hooks up with McManus for the first down. Simmons makes the play. We'll see what kind of latitude they give Morrell now. Clearly Marshall's going to have to open things up a little bit here to try to get the ball downfield.
Well, you got to take opportunities. I mean, what's the worst thing that can happen? You know, it's you get an opportunity. Maybe you get a pass interference call, or maybe you get a big play and at least try to get some points on the board.
This is Anderson running with the football to bring up a third down and short. And again, it's McCollum, their Will linebacker, making the play defensively. Western Kentucky's allowing just 24 points a game. That may sound like a lot, but it's really not, considering how many possessions the other teams get.
Yeah, because of the quick scoring that Western Kentucky's able to do. I mean, defense is, you know, their defense is not on the field very often. Everybody's rested, it seems like. And, you know, with the way this game's going right now, they're going to have plenty of time to rest for next week's ball game, too.
Third and short, and they run their little wildcat play again. And this is going to be really close. Anthony Anderson at 250 or so has the first down, and that'll move the sticks. Over the course of the last three, four seasons, these Marshall fans have been used to seeing the Thundering Herd put up big numbers offensively. This season, Marshall's averaging about 28 points a game, but you can see over the last couple of years, huge numbers for Doc Holliday and his team.
And you could see those numbers decreasing on the offensive side.
Here's Hunt running to near midfield. That'll move the sticks again. Hunt has been one of the leaders for Marshall. It's been a trying season for the Thundering Herd. And Hunt is one guy, a senior from Memphis, who in the locker room and on the field has maintained a positive attitude for his Marshall teammates.
Yeah, the coaches talked about Josh Knight and Justin Hunt, two of the guys that they could believe in as leaders, and they've shown that, as you said before, not only on the field but everywhere around this program.
Anderson plows ahead for a yard. It's something that's so unusual for Marshall fans, Marshall coaches. They're used to winning, and so fans at Oregon can relate, fans at
sure.
Michigan State can relate. You're used to winning big, and now you're sitting there at 3-8 coming into the Thanksgiving week game.
And the expectations were a little bit higher this year. Chase Linton, the starting quarterback as a freshman last year, had some success. They won a bunch of games, and they thought they had something possibly coming into this year, but they have not been able to run the football or do really anything offensively.
Morrell throws a fastball to the near sideline, and that'll be caught just across midfield. I say fastball because he's got a baseball future in him as well, if he'd like. McManus hauled in that fastball, but Morrell, coming out of Lee County High School in South Georgia, pretty good baseball prospect as well. They had to recruit him not only to come to Marshall to play football, but then convince him that this was his best sport.
Yeah, they had to double recruit him, quote unquote, from Bill Legg. He said we thought maybe we'd lose him as a football player in general. 95 mile an hour fastball and a guy that played some center field.
Third down, a flag is thrown. It's before the play. And, oh, Morrell, you don't get that in baseball, do you? No siree. Brown got a clear shot on him, and the fans here don't like it. It's an offside play. Marshall fans want a penalty.
Another procedure penalty on Marshall here, so that'll back him up a little bit and add a little bit more to that. You get the quarterback hit. But I like what Morrell did after that. I was watching him down on the field. He went over to all the offensive linemen. He tapped them all on the head. And that's some of the leadership qualities that you want to find in a young quarterback.
On third and 12, let's see if they can protect Morrell this time. He gets it away, delivers high. McManus, a leaping grab for the first down right in front of his own bench. That's a nice throw and catch. Let's get a quick check into the studio again. Here's Brendan again.
I want to take you out to the Pac-12. It's Utah and Colorado. The Buffs need to win this game to get to the Pac-12 championship game. But here's Booby Hobbs for the Utes. 55 yards on the punt return, and it is 7-0 Utah. Bill, back to you.
All right, Brendan, thanks so much. First down for Marshall on the move. Here's Anderson cutting it back inside the 30, and all of a sudden here in the second quarter,
The young man from Minnesota, Anthony Anderson, in this Marshall offense showing some life.
Now Anderson will give you some life. The big back, 252 pounds, has been running the ball fairly well over the last few ball games, and he's a guy they really like, a junior college transfer, and been banged up a little bit, starting to feel a little bit more healthy now, and that shows.
Well, Joe, let me ask you this. 2 years ago, it was 67-66 on this field when these teams played.
Mm-hmm.
That's what Marshall wants again tonight. It's hard to spot somebody a 35-point lead, but Marshall's trying to make it a shootout. Uh-oh, a misread route and a poor throw there by Moreau, and it's intercepted, and here comes Joe Brown the other way. Joe Brown still coming, and he's all the way down to the 41-yard line. So just when Marshall thought it had something going, a poor throw by Morrell or a wrong route run by his receiver, and here come the Hilltoppers, and here's some late pushing and shoving after the pick by Brown. Coach Brom pushing his players back. The last thing he wants is someone to throw a punch in there and then be suspended for next week's championship game if they hold on to win. Good job by this CUSA crew to make sure nothing happened, and a nice job keeping his players back. Well, they put some heat on Morrell that time, but it was not a good throw, was it, John?
No, well, it was a good throw if the receiver was running the same route, but he elected to break it off again. Last time they had the football going in the opposite direction, really the same thing happened, and you can look for the corner pass right here, what he thought the corner was going to do or what the receiver was going to do. Again, not on the same page, and that just goes back to not getting enough reps and not doing the things. It's a much easier thing in practice, and then to be on the same page, it takes some time and some experience together, and they just don't have it right now.
So Brown not only gets the interception, he returns it 51 yards, and here comes Mike White. He's completed 7 passes, 3 for touchdowns. And he's going to take a deep shot now, and it's overthrown in the end zone. Trying to hook up deep in the end zone. White wanted it all there on first down. Brian Brom is the play caller for his brother Jeff Brom. You know, when Brian played at Louisville, Jeff was his position coach. And Brian, of course, the last few years was playing in the CFL, and now he's making his coaching debut as the offensive coordinator on his brother's staff at Western Kentucky. White to the air again, and he misfires along the right sideline. It'll be third down.
Yeah, how about that? You get to play college football and your older brother's your coach. That doesn't happen often at all, but you can see these two guys, whether it's Brian Brom or Jeff Brom, both these guys, quarterback, wants to throw it down the football field, and this offense is just relentless. They're going to come after you. If you're not ready to play defensively, they're just going to keep throwing the football.
Western Kentucky has scored 5 touchdowns. This is its first third down conversion attempt of the night. That shows you how efficient this offense has been. And that's incomplete, and Marshall's defense gets its first stop of the night. And they'll force a Western Kentucky punt for the first time. As White pass intended for Richardson, it's incomplete.
You can see they're talking right there. That's Jeff Brom, the head coach on the side. He was asking him what happened. It looked like Mike White's left foot that time as he took a stride to throw the football, actually slipped out from underneath him, and maybe that's why that ball was incomplete.
Here's Jake Collins. He's punted just 34 times all year. You don't get to punt a whole lot if you play for Western Kentucky. Trying to kick it to the corner, and he muffs the punt out of bounds off the side of his foot. A poor effort. The ball was on the 40, and it goes out of bounds on the 32. Just an 8-yard punt. Marshall gets the ball when we come back on this Saturday night in Huntington. Well, let's take a look at our AT&T Inside Access. How do you take the field for your final home game and for every home game here at Marshall? Well, if you're Marco, the Marshall mascot, this is your grand entrance to lead the team onto the field.
Pretty good setup. I like it.
You saw that thing riding behind you on I-64. You'd get out of the way, wouldn't you, my man?
It would get your attention.
Marshall with the ball back. Morrell short hops. That's Knight trying to make the diving grab just across the 40-yard line. Couldn't come up with it. Well, if anything, they're moving Morrell around a little bit now here in the second quarter.
I was going to say, that's a little bit something I would like. I mean, this offense pretty stagnant. I mean, they don't motion a whole lot of guys. When you watch this football team play, you have a lot of guys standing in place, and defenses can kind of get a read on what they're trying to do. I like a little bit of motion as you look around the country. A lot of teams motion and try to confuse some people, and they're pretty stagnant on the offensive side of it.
First man was covered. Morrell tries to get out of there with it, and he gets knocked down near the 33. You know, they've been really hit hard by injuries, probably at one position more so than any other is tight end. Ryan Juracek's been knocked down. Emmanuel Bird is hurt. They've had to move A.J. Addison, a tackle, to tight end. And you're Doc Holliday, and you got a young quarterback start. You'd kind of like to have some tight ends to pitch and catch with, but you don't have any.
Yes, especially when you look at the numbers on the year. Juracek had 27 catches on the year, along with Emmanuel Bird, who had 26 catches. So this offense is built around where the tight ends can really get involved.
Morrell gets hit hard, and it's another sack back on the 22-yard line. That was Derek Overstreet from Paducah lowering the boom on Morrell.
Two defensive ends in Overstreet and Dawson Brents. Of course, Dawson Brents, the transfer for Louisville, and Overstreet, a return starter on this football team. He was the MVP of the Bahamas Bowl back in 2014, 32 consecutive starts. So the experience they have up front against a very young Marshall offensive line because of injuries, it's just overmatched right now.
Vednik's punt goes out of bounds near midfield. Western Kentucky will get a ball right near the midfield stripe when we come back. Derek Overstreet and the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers on the road, up 35-0 here in this first half in Huntington. Well, our college football primetime in Huntington, West Virginia tonight. Western Kentucky hoping to advance the next week's championship game, leading 35-0, and we'll start this possession from midfield. And it'll be second down. Hey, next Sunday, a week from tomorrow, we'll have the college football playoff selection show, a 4-hour special exclusively revealing the college football playoff semifinal matchups in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl and the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl on New Year's Eve. Recently, the guys will also unveil the other New Year's Six bowl games and have the final top 25 rankings. It all starts at noon Eastern on ESPN, also available streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. First down for White. And he connects again with Taylor. That's enough for the first down, I believe. Hey, what'd you think earlier today? The number 2 versus number 3 game, Michigan-Ohio State.
Yeah, pretty impressive. Overtime, you know, you just wonder what happens to Michigan after that. Ohio State really couldn't get anything going. Defensively, they scored in the first half and able to really play well in overtime. Quite surprising how easy they were able to score.
Taylor with another reception, and he gets belted out of bounds. It'll be a gain of about 7 yards. Gant made the play defensively for the Thundering Herd.
The other game that maybe some of these Western Kentucky fans, how about that Louisville and Kentucky football game? Kentucky going on the road and winning at Louisville. They were a 27-point underdog in that game.
Well, that's what this whole week is about, the whole rivalries around the country, whether it's Florida, Florida State, the Michigan-Ohio State game today. And this game has had a lot to say who wins the division in Conference USA, but it's tonight been all Western Kentucky. You go back to the beginning of the season, Western Kentucky replacing Dowdy at quarterback. White comes in right off the get-go, and they've ripped off an 8-3 season. They did lose to Louisiana Tech in a shootout earlier in the season, but if they win tonight, John, they'll get them at home next Saturday.
And that makes a big difference. This Western Kentucky football team very comfortable being at home. That's going to be an early start for them next week, but a big game getting that opportunity to play at home.
White trying to improvise, throwing on the run, and he connects again. Ruled now an incomplete pass. Lucky Jackson trying to scoop it up off the grass.
Going up against Chris Jackson, but he did not catch it. That'll be second down.
Now, Mike White's not a guy that's going to rush the football an awful lot, but he can keep the play alive, and he does here. And I like what his wide receiver, Lucky Jackson, did. He fought his way to come back and try to help his quarterback this time, just wasn't able to come up with the catch.
They've had 30 pass plays this year go for touchdowns of 40 yards or more. They do a great job of going over the top, trying to hit you deep. And nobody's been able to stop them for the most part since that Alabama game. Second and 10. They try to set up the screen. It's defended well. That's one of the best plays that Marshall's had on the evening defensively. And again, it's Chris Jackson, who's played well tonight. He had that strip in the end zone, and he's had several pass breakups in this second quarter.
Yeah, and Chris Jackson's a true freshman. They're really high on this guy. And early in the year, boy, there were teams picking on him. They knew he was a freshman out there at the cornerback position. And Chuck Heater put him in situations early in the year with man-to-man coverage and took some lumps early, but he's playing a lot better now.
On third down, let's see what White has for us. The Tops just 0 of 1 tonight on third down. Gets some heat, lets it go to the end zone area, and it's incomplete. He was trying to connect on the far sideline to Norris, but it'll be fourth down. Well, Marshall got some heat on him. And they'll force another Western Kentucky punt or a pretty long field goal attempt. Let's see what Coach Braum goes with here. It will be the field goal attempt of 43, 44 yards, it appears.
You know, pressure on the quarterback. The one thing Marshall's done defensively this year, pretty good, 34th in the nation with 27 sacks. So they found the ability to get to the quarterback some this year.
It'll be a 41-yard field goal attempt officially for Skyler Simcox. And he got it. And with 5:23 to go, Simcox knocks home his 10th field goal of the season and makes it 38-0 Western Kentucky. All Hilltoppers on the road tonight here in the hills of West Virginia. Well, Tuesday at 9:30 p.m. Eastern Time on ESPN, we'll have number 24 in Michigan State and number 6 Duke in the ACC Big Ten Challenge from Cameron Indoor. You know, John, Coach K, 8-1 against Tom Izzo and the Spartans. Duke's won the last 5 meetings with Sparty. Also streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Tell you what, Michigan State's played everybody but the Warriors in the first 3 weeks, 4 weeks of the season. What a schedule Michigan State has played in basketball. Here's the return, and Marshall tries to get something going here, trailing 38-0. I love it, though. These early season basketball games, there's some games that the scores come across, and you go, who was that, and they beat them by how many?
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, scheduling's all about it, and football, all the talk is about scheduling, what they're going to do. Basketball early, you know, some of these teams get some early wins against some easy teams, easy victories, but as you said, Michigan State, they'll play anybody early, and I think it helps down the road.
Well, it helps your frequent flyer mileage balance, that's for sure. Coach Izzo actually apologized to his guys the other night. He said, I've overscheduled you. They've gone coast to coast into the Caribbean. All right, we got about 5 minutes left in this first half. It's been a better second quarter for Marshall. They got down 28-0 after one. At least they're playing a little bit more spirited here in the second quarter. That guy Anderson has had a nice period. He's played well in the second quarters, Anderson.
I was thinking the same thing defensively last time. It looked like Marshall was running around a little bit more, a little more enthusiasm defensively, and you know that's what these coaches want to do right now. They're getting a look at a lot of young guys.
Here's Morrell to the left side, and it's deflected incomplete off the hands of Knight. That's something that they really liked, his ability to throw the ball from the right hash mark to the left side. Strong arm for this freshman quarterback from Leesburg, Georgia, played at Lee County High School, the southern part of the state.
Man, Bill Legg said he would not recruit a quarterback unless he saw him in person, wanted to see how the ball came out of his hand and if he had the ability to throw it, you know, across the field from the far hash mark.
Third and 10. They've had a lot of third and longs tonight. We got a flag on the play, and that's going to be obviously well defended as Clark made the grab, and he was knocked down by Joe Brown. Here's the call. Now that gives Marshall a free first down as Overstreet called for roughing the passer. Perhaps a generous call, but nonetheless, Marshall and Coach Holliday will take it. It's a first down by penalty, and Marshall will maintain possession out to the 46. Morrell going to put it up again. Little bubble screen to Knight. Nowhere to go, and the Hilltoppers corral him, but we may have a face mask here right in front of the Marshall bench on about the 46-yard line. That was Iggy that got him around the face mask, and he's talking it over with his teammates, and the officials are talking it over as well.
I thought maybe they were going to get Justin Hunt withholding that time. The wide receiver out there trying to block for his teammate. You can see the block going on right there. There was a little holding that Marshall got away with, and then clearly the hand on the face mask.
So back-to-back 15-yard penalties, a roughing the passer call and the face mask, as the Thundering Herd across the 40-yard line of Western Kentucky here as we come out down to the final 4 minutes of the second quarter. Garrett Morrell making his second career start, true freshman. Again, the short throw, and it's mishandled by McManus. Incomplete. 3:47 to go. That was Simmons from Royal Palm Beach, Florida. You remember early in the season, he had an amazing juggling interception against Rice. He made all the highlights shows, that young man from Royal Palm Beach.
That was the number one, right? ESPN highlight for that week.
On second down, Morrell hands it off this time. There goes Anderson, giving ground, not against that defense. It'll bring up another third down long. Both of these teams do a really good job of recruiting Florida, particularly South Florida.
You're right, Doc Holliday for years and years has been down in that area. But when you talk about the Louisville football team, Western Kentucky, Marshall coaches, they've battled four players out of that same area down in southeastern Florida. And now doing a really good job out of the state of Georgia, both of these football teams.
Another third and long for Morrell and the Thundering Herd, trailing by 38 here on their home field. Morrell steps into that one down the left sideline, but it's incomplete again. And a flag is thrown. Marshall's going to get its third first down via penalty on this possession. That time it was Joe Brown going up against Michael Clark.
And if you're Marshall, why not take that shot with Michael Clark? He's 6'7". You know, throw it up and give him a chance.
Pass interference. Defense, number 7. 15 yards. We added the previous spot. First down.
Tough to see there. Joe Brown, you could hear him with the referee's microphone on. He was still complaining that that was not pass interference. And again, you got a guy 6'7" against a 5'10" cornerback in Joe Brown.
From the 27, here goes Anderson around the left end, and he pops it free. And Anderson's near the 12-yard line. Tackled by the safety from Clearwater, Florida, Brandon Leston, but it's a strong run again for Anderson of Marshall.
Boy, and Leston, you could see him at the end of that play. 205 pounds against 250 pounds as Anderson got around the corner. And he's a guy with 250 pounds, but really good feet. But he ran over Leston at the end of that play.
Fortunately for Marshall, it's coming back by penalty. But unfortunately for Leston, he's shaken up on the play and has to leave the game.
And that's not a good sign for Western Kentucky. Hopefully he's okay. Leston, number 2 on this team, coming into the ballgame with 77 tackles on the year.
Fifth-year man from the Tampa area. They will need him next week if they hold on to win, with Louisiana Tech coming to town. Here's Morrell running. He puts his head down and runs over Joe Brown. See if we can figure out what happened. Leston at safety is about 205. And you see he goes low to try to tackle the very physical Anthony Anderson at 252. And he was shaken up on the play.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Defense, number 9. 15 yards will be added to the end of the run. It'll be first down. That is number 9's first unsportsmanlike conduct penalty as it goes towards disqualification.
So the fourth major penalty on this possession against Western Kentucky. That one on Omarius Bryant. Young man from Bryan, Mississippi, who starts a defensive tackle. So that gives Marshall a first down on the 19. This is the deepest penetration of this first half for Doc Holliday's team. By the way, Leston back in the game at safety. Burrell to the end zone, and it is caught and then dropped. Broken up nicely along the goal line. Leston may have got his hands on that, so he comes right back in the game and gets the pass breakup.
And Leston gets there just in time. A lot like the play that Western Kentucky scored on earlier today, a play fake trying to draw up the linebacker, and Leston getting there just in time to be able to dislodge that football and take away a touchdown for Marshall.
Nice play call by Bill Legg. He says, all right, Leston's back. Let's see if you're ready to go. And they go right at him. He gets the pass breakup. From the 19, Pittman. Giving ground, another flag is thrown on the play. Overstreet brought him down as we approach the two-minute mark of this first half. This has been a yellow hanky-filled possession. Penalties on both sides. This one apparently is against the Thundering Herd. Dan Gautreaux.
Holding. Offense number 76. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Remains second down.
Marshall's been penalized now 9 times for 70 yards in the first half. That's a lot of penalties.
Yeah, and that's probably one of the biggest problems that Marshall's had this year. You know, when you talk about crossing the 50-yard line, look at the example, Florida International. They did it 9 times in that football, and 7 of the 9 times they came away with no points. So they seem to find a way to make a mistake once they cross that 50-yard line.
On second down, it's about second down and 19 for Morrell. They try to set up the screen. Pittman can't hang on to the grab. It'll be third down. Got to make that catch. Senior Pittman couldn't hold it. And it'll be third down at about 19 with a minute 42 to play.
Morrell limping a little bit after this play. Let's see. Ah, I just foot stepped on down there, and that doesn't feel good. So many times you see a quarterback get stepped on by his own offensive lineman, and it really hurts on a cold night like this.
Third down from the 30. And Morrell lets it go. And here's McManus with the grab, and he's pushed out of bounds. It'll be about 10 yards shy of the first down as DeAndre Simmons made the play. It'll be fourth and 10 here. Let's see if the Herd goes for a field goal to get on the board or they decide to go for it, trailing 38-0 here in the second period.
McManus had no catches in that first quarter. We've seen him throw the ball a little bit more to him. He had a breakout game last week of 10 catches for 151 yards in that football game, including a touchdown pass.
With a minute to go in the first half, Marshall goes for it on fourth down. They're good at this over the course of the season. In fact, at 15 of 21, they lead Conference USA in fourth down conversions. Ball delivered high and incomplete, and the Western Kentucky defense holds on downs as Morrell's pass, intended for Michael Clark, delivered high. And so the Hilltoppers will get the ball to finish off the first half, already leading here 38-0, and you see Morrell continues to limp as he goes to the sideline after his teammate stepped on his toe.
Now for Marshall, it continues after passing the 50-yard line. You know, in Conference USA games, coming into this ball game 38 times against Conference USA opponents, they were in the past the 50-yard line, and 25 of those times they come out with missed opportunities. So that's been the story for this offense.
48 seconds remaining here in the first half. Hilltoppers with the football. Wales gets run out of bounds. Allen makes the play defensively. And with 43 seconds to go, Western Kentucky will have a second down. Chilly night here in Huntington. But the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers, who have been so hot of late, the defending Conference USA champs, let it be known right away what was going to happen tonight, returning the opening kick for a touchdown and then scoring on their first possession. That'll stop the clock with 37 seconds to go. First carry of the night for Nicholas Norris. He held in his 13th touchdown of the season earlier here today. Only 10 other players in college football have that many touchdowns, as that senior from Miami, number 15 in white. By the way, very cool helmets for the Hilltoppers. 30 seconds to go. And Western Kentucky will call timeout after Wales was knocked to the turf by Corey Neely. That'll stop the clock with the timeout. 29 seconds left, and Coach Brohm's going to call White over. Leading 38-0, and again with 29 seconds remaining here in this first half. Western Kentucky will have two timeouts remaining now, looking for its ninth win of the season for Coach Brohm and his team.
It's a perfect example right here with 29 seconds to go in this first half, up 38-0. Not happy with that. They're going to call timeout and try to get another opportunity to put some points on the board. And that's what Jeff Brohm, this offense, is all about. Is they're going to continue to pressure you from the first play of the game to the last play.
Boy, he had such a tremendous career at Louisville, as his brother did. And all three Brohm brothers are now working together at Western Kentucky. And it's been an exciting period for the Hilltoppers and Western Kentucky fans. First down with 28 seconds to go. That's a gain of 11, and the clock will stop momentarily. Allen made the grab, 23 seconds remaining here in the first half. And now the clock starts as the ball is ready for play, and White's going to throw it deep down the right side. A jump ball. Incomplete on the 20-yard line. Maybe a bit underthrown. That stops the clock with 15 seconds to go. He tried to let Taylor go up and make a play in the chilly nighttime sky. Taylor went leaping for it, incomplete.
Yeah, sometimes as a quarterback, you want to get back there, get rid of that football as quick as you can. When you have a guy like Taywan Taylor that can really stretch the field, cold night like this, you got to let that thing go because he's a guy that can run underneath it.
15 seconds remaining. To the sideline. Ooh, that's the biggest stick of the night. Rodney Allen, corner on the near side, lowering the boom. And a timeout taken. Now 10 seconds left. It'll be third down. Coach Brohm and the Tops have two plays left, you'd think.
And they're going to use up every second they possibly can. And, you know, you'd think most teams and most coaches will say, I'm happy 38-0 right now. Let's go in. But not the case. And you could see Allen here putting a good hit on him. We mentioned before, Rodney Allen's actually leading the conference in pass breakups this year, coming into this game with 11.
Well, Mike White's thrown three touchdowns here in this game tonight. Junior came in. The name Doughty's so big over the last few years for Western Kentucky. White beat out Tyler Ferguson late in the preseason camp. He's had a tremendous season, and he's been pitching darts all night in Huntington.
And the thing you like about this offense, it's not just the receivers. He's got a touchdown pass to his running back. He really spreads the football around.
10 seconds to play, and White going to throw another one. And he's got his man at the 30, and that'll stop the clock. Out of bounds with 4 seconds to play. Very well executed. Shaquille Johnson, the senior from Lake City, Florida, makes the grab and steps out of bounds. Very well done. Heady play by the tight end to know he had to get out of bounds. If he fights for 5 more yards, 10 more yards, the period ends.
Smart football there, giving your guys an opportunity to kick a field goal here as time's going to run out in the first half.
4 seconds left. Skyler Simcox, who's 10 of 14 on the year. This will be his season long. It'll be a 47-yarder. His previous career high was just 31 against Rice.
Marshall. It is their first. It will be 30 seconds.
Interesting possession for Western Kentucky. And Simcox will have a few minutes, or in this instance, 30 seconds to think about it before trying his longest field goal with 4 seconds left here in this first half.
I'm not sure if Marshall had enough guys on the field that time, or they just maybe tried to call the timeout to ice him here. Curious. Seemed like they had everybody together out there.
So this will be a 47-yarder on what will be the final play of the first half for a young man from Abingdon, Virginia, Skyler Simcox from the left hash. And it is line drive right through there. As the first half comes to an end, Simcox knocks home his second field goal of the game and his longest of the year as well. And Western Kentucky has made a statement, 41-0 at halftime here at Marshall. Now let's go to the studio. Brendan Fitzgerald and Charles Arbuckle. Fellas.
Bill, thanks very much. Statement made indeed by the Hilltoppers.
Halftime in Huntington. It is all Western Kentucky tonight on the road, along with John Gregory, Bill Roth, here at Marshall Stadium. Well, Western Kentucky as good as advertised. Boy, have they been good tonight on the road with the East Division title on the line. They have shown us they can score in a myriad of ways.
Yeah, it started quick for Western Kentucky as it normally does, and they really haven't let up throughout this entire first half.
Knowing that a victory tonight sends them to the league championship game next week, right from the opening kickoff, they fake the reverse, and Towner goes 93 yards to get us going. It was 7-0 Western Kentucky, and then White really started heating up.
Yeah, he found his wide receivers there quickly as Taywan Taylor gets in for a quick score.
And he connects with Wales for a touchdown. It was 28-0 early in the first quarter. And this Western Kentucky offense that averages over 40 points a game kept clicking in quarter number two. Here's Norris taking it to the house. And it was 35-0 Hilltoppers in the second. And Mike White with the jacket on down there is sizzling on this chilly night. 186 yards and 3 touchdowns in the first half.
Yeah, great effort for him starting out 3 touchdowns, and really they haven't let up at all. And we can imagine that they're going to come out here in the second half and continue to try to put some points on the board. And I'm sure Doc Halliday went in there and talked with his defense and let them know that this team is not going to let up.
As well as it played offensively, check out the defense for Western Kentucky. They held that thundering herd to just 93 yards of total offense in the first half.
Marshall just has not been able to get any type of running game going in that first half, and because of that, they've been forced into throwing situation and some self-inflicted penalties as far as guys jumping off sides, a couple delay of game penalties early for the young quarterback, but those are the growing pains that you're going to get from a true freshman quarterback.
Green, about 2 yards deep, will take a knee. It'll be a touchback, and Marshall will get the ball. Well, 41-0, not much you can say if you were Coach Holiday other than go out there and try to win the second half for the seniors. And while there are 13 on the Marshall roster, 4 of them will be playing here in this second half. You know they want to go out with some pride here on their home field.
No, absolutely. These seniors have pride in the 4 guys that are out there on the field that are fighting to do this. You know, they want to go out on a positive note, and certainly it hasn't been that way in the first half. But you know, for this coaching staff, yes, they feel for these seniors going out of here, but there's a lot of film to watch in this offseason. They're going to try to find some young guys who have the heart, have the desire, that want to play Herd football.
Morrell, the true freshman from South Georgia, making just his second start. That's a bit of a low snap, and he misfires to McManus in the right flat. Morrell talking with his center, Nate Devers, the sophomore. Showed some good leadership there. Said, hey, man, bad snap. Don't worry about it. We'll get it again.
And you get a bad snap like that, it just throws the timing off. And as a wide receiver out there, you could see Deontay McManus. I mean, he wasn't pleased with that throw either. And it's just that attitude. They just got to find a way to come together as a team.
First second half carry for Anthony Anderson, and the Hilltoppers are there to get him. That's Derek Overstreet again. He's had a good game tonight for Western Kentucky under that veteran defensive coordinator, Nick Holt. Overstreet's from Paducah.
How about talking with Nick Holt this week? I mean, he is a fiery guy and guy that had an opportunity to go to Louisville a couple years ago, decided he wanted to stay. Now he has an opportunity to coach his younger son after coaching his elder son last year.
Son Ben, outside linebacker on this team. That ball's ruled incomplete. Marshall receiver Josh Knight, hoping for a flag, did not get it on the play. And it will bring up a fourth down for the home team. Did Josh Knight have a beef on the non-call? Looks that way.
Yeah, that was pretty obvious there that that was pass interference. I'm surprised that we did not see a flag on that.
Corey Vedvik will kick it away for the Herd. And Towner calls forward, takes the fair catch. Well, if you're just joining us, don't go away. We're about to see that Western Kentucky offense back out on the field coming up on the other side of the break. Well, let's introduce you to this young man, the fifth-year senior from Louisville, Anthony Wales. Fourth in the country in rushing. He picked up rushing scores, I should say. Picked up his 19th touchdown running tonight. But he's been terrific catching the ball as well. Anthony has been terrific for Western Kentucky.
He can beat you many ways, and one of those is receiving the football. Had 19 catches coming into this ball game for 149 yards, so not afraid to spread it around to different receivers numerous times. Eight guys during the ball game will catch balls for this Western Kentucky team.
First down running play. You almost expect them to hand that ball to him a whole bunch here in the second half, leading 41 to nothing. Now, his name is Anthony. His teammates call him Ace Wales. But Mama doesn't like that.
No. We were talking with the sports information director before the ball game, and he said, call him that if you want to. Now, his mom's going to tweet out, though, hey, I named him Anthony for a reason.
Quick throw from White on the slant, and it's dropped on the far side. A rare drop for Taywan Taylor. Psychologically, when you're ahead in the game 41-0, first possession of the third quarter, it can be hard on either side to maintain one's focus, no?
Absolutely, and I mean, that's what I'm sure Jeff Brohm was telling his football team. We're not going to let up. You got to come out. But boy, is it hard to keep that momentum and that enthusiasm going on a cold night like this, knowing that you've got a very important game next week. But got to be careful. As soon as you let down, that's when the injury bug comes around and everything. So you got to maintain your intensity at all times.
Here is White and the junior from Fort Lauderdale. Nice flip to Lucky Jackson, and that'll be enough for the first down ahead to near the 34-yard line. Rodney Allen made the play. The one thing that this Western Kentucky team has is amazing combination receivers in Taylor and Norris.
Well, you look at the numbers that they have combined for over the past couple years, 1,340 yards coming in the game for Taylor. He said before he set the record last year and on pace to go ahead of that this year. Touchdown numbers are incredible.
Here goes Ace. Look out in open field. And he's ahead of the Marshall 40-yard line. 26 more yards on the ground for Anthony Wales. That was Neely who finally tracked him down.
Wales up the middle again, and just huge holes by this offensive line as they continue to just help their quarterback and their running backs out. And boy, they're impressive up front.
He's up over 100 yards rushing. Pitch and catch to Taylor again. And he's pushed out of bounds again by Rodney Allen. For the Marshall defense and coordinator Chuck Heater, who, much like the coordinator on the other sideline tonight, Nick Holt, has won a national championship, there's not a whole lot you can do. We've asked other coaches, how do you slow down Western Kentucky? And no one really has. Now out of the pistol formation. Coming back on the screen. Here goes Norris in open field. Cuts it back to the left. A sprint to the corner. And he's out of bounds just shy of the goal line. They're going to see actually stepped out on the floor as Rodney Allen was able to catch up with the speedy Nicholas Norris.
You know, the thing about this offense is we've seen them throw a lot of deep balls down the field, but so many times this team gets yards after the catch and guys crossing.
My mistake, they actually said he was knocked down on the one. They run quickly, and that time Wales has stopped shy. Initially, we thought maybe he got in, but the ball in his left hand did not break the plane.
Ball has to break the plane. Clearly his foot got in there, but the ball out over the sideline.
But two plays later, no problem for Wales. That's his 20th rushing touchdown of the season. And that is a new Western Kentucky record. He's run for two tonight to set the all-time school record. And Wales adds six more to the Western Kentucky total.
Well, it looks pretty easy when you have a guy that's that talented and you got that offensive line up front and they're just getting a push off of this defensive line. We mentioned for Marshall on the offensive line, missing players. Ryan B., the big defensive end for Marshall on that right side, not in there tonight. And offensive line for Western Kentucky just really dominating.
First possession of the third quarter, Western Kentucky pounds it in. Another touchdown, and the Hilltoppers now lead 48-0 on the road.
ESPNU College Football is brought to you by Bass Pro Shops. Your adventure starts here.
Senior night here at Marshall University, and the Thundering Herd celebrated before the game. 14 seniors were introduced prior to kickoff here tonight. Unfortunately, it has been an evening that has been dominated by the visitors from Western Kentucky, who have opened up a 48-0 lead early here in this third quarter. Marshall gets the ball back. We keep waiting for the spark. Green thought about it, now decides after hesitating to run it back, and he'll get knocked down shy of the 20. You know, John, over the years, this has been a really tough stadium for visiting teams to win. In fact, coming into this night, this evening's game, Marshall second only to Houston in terms of winning percentage in their current stadium.
Yeah, and this numbers this year kind of go along with that, trying to avoid the first ever four loss season for this stadium. Never before Marshall have lost four games at home. It's just been that type of year for Marshall.
25 years this stadium has been here. Marshall runs it on first down. And the physical tailback, Anthony Anderson, at 252 pounds. Gets six or so on the first down play. It'll be second at about four for Pittman. Marshall knew coming into this game that it would be its final game of the season. And after regrouping, they're going to go back and try to figure out what went wrong. Yeah, there were a lot of injuries, but they lost a few games before they started losing players with the attrition.
Yeah, you're right about that. I mean, they win the first game of the year, and they really struggled after that before the injuries came, although they started to mount up pretty quickly. You know, they'd get a guy healthy and then get him back in the lineup, and they would lose somebody else right after that. But, you know, this is a team, you know, you're recruiting athletes out here that try to fit in a lineup, and all these guys want to start.
And a great winning culture here. Marshall's won 33 games over the last 3 years. They're the only what you'd call a group of five team that's won at least 10 games in each of the last three seasons. So what Doc Holliday has done here at Marshall has been remarkable. But tonight and this season, very unusual. Norrell throws that one away. The Marshall players thought there should have been a flag on the play, but Nick Dawson Brents, the former Louisville Cardinal, was coming full speed ahead.
I'm very surprised we didn't get another flag there.
There is the flag.
Defense, number 12. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
Nick's tough enough to block. Give him a half a yard head start. No one's going to block him. Yeah, He's clearly offside.
Maybe a yard and a half, too.
But what's interesting about this team, and Nick is one player. We've talked about middle linebacker Keith Brown as well. Two former Louisville Cardinals transferred into Western Kentucky, and they have come in and started and been impact players. Brown number two and Nick Dawson Brents. They have not only fit in on the field locker room as well. Here's Anderson running. He's going to get the first down across the 30-yard line. And that can be tough when you transfer in and you move right into that starting lineup. But they've done a really nice job at Western Kentucky of taking the former Cardinals. Yes. Red and white jerseys and uniforms and whatnot. And they put on the Western Kentucky red and white. And they've not missed a beat.
Yeah, really. You know, sometimes when you're a transfer, you can really mess up the chemistry that a defense has. But not the case for Keith Brown and Dawson Brents, because Brown has come in there. This team has accepted him. Now he's leading the team in tackles. And heck, he had 10 in the first half of this football game.
Morrell, a pitch and catch to McManus again on the near sideline. He'll get a head to about the 36-yard line, diving at the feet of Overstreet. Brown has already graduated. He's a young man from Miami. Same thing for Dawson Brents, who's from Charlotte and also a graduate.
Deontay McManus outside trying to do whatever he can. Remember, we said last game had 10 catches. He came on in that second quarter with a few catches for Marshall. So trying to get the ball to him. He's on the near side.
Tony Pittman runs, and he's near the first down and should have it across the 42-yard line. That'll keep the clock moving. Marshall has held to under 100 yards in the first half. So we've been raving about the great job of Western Kentucky's offense tonight, but its defense has been dynamite as well. Pittman was shaken up on the play. He's going to stay in the game. Beaver sends it back on the shotgun. Morrell on the move. Lets it go. And a leaping grab. Gain of about 9 yards. So if you're Louisiana Tech, you're thinking if we beat the Southern Miss, we're going to host the championship game, although it would be moved to Independence Stadium in Shreveport. Mm-hmm. They lose that game. Now it appears they're going to have to go on the road next week.
Sure.
To Western Kentucky. That kind of changes the mindset in a bit, doesn't it?
Yeah, it certainly does. And Western Kentucky got a big lift after the fact. They saw that, knowing that they had that opportunity. And, of course, with Old Dominion winning today, they needed to get the victory tonight. They don't win tonight, then, you know, they're out of the championship and have a chance to just play in a bowl game. So a lot of things transpired over the last couple days that's really helped this football team as far as Western Kentucky goes.
Pittman brought down shy of the first down. It'll be about a third down and two coming up now for Marshall.
Now, and this is manageable, and they got to pick this thing up. And as you mentioned before, this Marshall team just frustrated offensively all year. And Bill Legg has had such great success over his career here, too. I mean, he's had 31 games over 500 yards. So you talk about the expectations of the fans and all that. This team has produced they've had 40 games with 30 points or more, or 40 points. So they're a team that can put the numbers on the board. This year has been a little bit different for them.
You're right, John. Direct snap, and there goes Anderson to the near sideline, and McCollum made the play. Well, Louisiana Tech and Western Kentucky played earlier this year, a high-scoring game, and you see what happened. Western Kentucky came roaring back to cut it to three and had that turnover in the final couple of minutes. If this holds up, which clearly it will, with a 48-0 game, they'll have a rematch next Saturday at Western Kentucky on ESPN. Here's Morrell throwing it deep down the right side, and no one's home. With 5:26 to go, Morrell will give it another shot. Here's Bill Legg, the offensive coordinator for Marshall University, who played his collegiate football at West Virginia University under legendary coach Don Nealon. In fact, Bill was the very first recruit from Nealon, who had that amazing run at WVU, and Bill's had a great coaching career up there, down here, and at Purdue as well. After the pump fake, Morrell lets it go and is caught. First down as Clark had it and then could not hang on. Incomplete.
You don't see that very often from Michael Clark, as the big receiver has been able to go up and make some big catches for this football team this year, but clearly open here. You just wonder, was he anticipating getting hit on this? But ball just bouncing off his hands. The former basketball player used to going up and getting rebounds and not able to come down with the football there.
And now on third down, Morrell will let it go again. And just his second start, take another deep shot for Clark again. Much tougher catch, and he goes up in a crowd and hauls it in right in front of Gardner, the safety. Well, they dropped the last one, but Michael Clark goes up in a crowd and takes it right away from the safety. First down for the Thundering Herd.
Yeah, I said last play that you don't usually see it from this big guy, his ability to go up and make catches. We've seen it really all year from him, his ability to do that, and that shows right there, is able to fight back. I love it. Not giving up on it and staying with it and able to come up with a big catch for the Herd.
Morrell down to the 15-yard line. Looking to get Marshall on the board. He's going to take off running. Morrell inside the 10. Near the first down, inside the 5-yard line. It will be first and goal to go for the Thundering Herd as Morrell gives Marshall a bit of a lift here in the second half.
Yeah, you like the effort here for Morrell as he's running the football. It's a little different than what Chase Litton will give you. He's typically a guy that'll have to fool you to run the football, but Morrell, not a guy to try to lower his head and get some points. And look, it's because you're blocking down the field and wide receiver. I thought Clark was going to give up on that and then decided to pick up a block late.
From the four, Morrell turns and hands it off this time to Pittman. And as you mentioned, this is where the Herd has had some trouble this year, not only on the 50-yard line, but inside the 20, inside the red zone. And the Herd spent a lot of time this week with Morrell in the high red, deep inside the 10-yard line, because this isn't an area where he took a lot of snaps during the course of the season in practice.
That's right. Bill Legg said, you know, things get so much faster once you get down inside the red zone, and especially inside the 10-yard line. Things speed up so much. They tried to give him some extra work down here to be able to try to score when they get the opportunity.
On Thursday at the end of practice, they put an extra period in and let Morrell just do goal line. Morrell on the move. Oh, and he goes down to avoid a big headshot. McCollum got him low, and he went down. It'll be third and goal.
Now, think about that. It's how bad it's been for this team with injuries and everything else going on. You're into your last game of the year, and you're staying after for some extra work to try to get a young quarterback to try to teach him, you know, how they were going to react down there by the goal line. So that's just part of the struggles that Marshall's had to face this year, and it's only, you know, a big part of that is the injury side of things.
Morrell in for the injured Chase Litton tonight. Now it's third and goal for this rookie from Georgia. And nothing doing up front. It'll be fourth down and goal. Pittman brought down by E.A. Booneyway, and it will be fourth down and goal. Marshall apparently will go for it again. A field goal, other than getting that goose egg off the board, doesn't help him at all. Marshall's 0 for 1 tonight on fourth downs. Here's Morrell on the move, flips it to the end zone, and it is caught. That's your check for the touchdown, and Marshall finally gets on the board.
Ryan Juracek, a guy that we really didn't expect to see tonight. He was kind of a game-time decision. Bill Legg told us last night that they're going to make the decision. They thought 80% chance he'd play on Monday, and that went down to about 50%. Saw that he was inserted down there, and he is a playmaker on this football team, and there's a guy that you can trust in Juracek, and good for the Herd. They were able to get on the board.
Uh-oh, extra point coming the other way. Here goes Joe Brown sprinting for the 2 points for the Hilltoppers. Extra point blocked, and Brown takes it the other way. And that makes it 50-6. Well, Brown had a pick six. And now he gets the long run back on the blocked extra point. Well, Western Kentucky has scored nearly every conceivable way tonight. And on the block extra point, Brown makes it 50-6. Well, Garrett Morrell talking with his offensive coordinator, Bill Legg. His touchdown pass to the tight end, Ryan Juracek, gets Marshall on the board. Joe Brown on the block PAT runs it the other way for 2 points, and that's why we have a 50-6 game. Let's take a look at the touchdown. Finally, Marshall fans had something to cheer about, and the band could play the fight song for the first time tonight.
And a nice throw by Morrell as he gets to the outside and finds Juracek, and boy, he's been a difference maker for this football team over the past few years, and nice to see him get back in the lineup, even with the knee brace on there and the ability to kind of light up maybe the scoreboard for the Herd for the first time.
That took nearly 9 minutes off the clock, and Juracek, who did not play last week at FIU, gets it in for the first Marshall score of the game. Under 2 minutes to go in the third quarter. Here's the young man from Ashland, Kentucky, breaking free across the 50. Quinton Baker has family and friends here tonight, and they're making a lot of noise after number three bursts free for a long run. That's a 24-yard gain for the true freshman from Ashland, Kentucky.
Tough to tackle in the open field there, and how about that? Anthony Wales having a heck of a day today, and then you can bring a guy in like Quinton Baker that he's got plenty of left in his legs right now.
You can see the fresh legs of Baker. Here he goes again, a gigantic hole for Baker, and he rips it free ahead of the Marshall 25-yard line, and finally dragged down by Neely, the safety. Whoa, hello, Quinton Baker. Welcome to Huntington, and welcome home, young man.
Well, you can see him just finding that hole, that big offensive line, continuing to open up some big running spaces for these backs, and Baker not hesitating at all to hit the hole.
Illegal substitution. Defense. 12 men on the field. You're in a live ball. The penalty is declined. First down.
Quinton Baker, three carries on the game, 50 yards for number three, who a year ago today was committed to play here for Marshall. But the week after the Marshall-Western Kentucky game last year, which was played on the road, he changed his commitment. Three carries in a row, and he stumbles and maintains his footing. And there he goes, pushed out of bounds over there by Neely, right in front of the Western Kentucky fans. In that far corner of the stadium here. I believe Mr. Baker has a full tank. He wants to get in the end zone, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's going to try to find that end zone quickly. Nice shift there. He plants his foot and gets up inside, and he's forced outside. And you said it. He's the guy that was the local product out of Ashland, Kentucky. Had 1,976 yards and 26 touchdowns his senior year.
Here's Ferguson's throw to the right corner of the end zone, and it's nearly intercepted. Incomplete pass. Allen had the coverage. Ferguson, who is a gentleman who played at Penn State back in 2013 and transferred from Louisville in January with his first pass of the night.
Boy, you can see the difference when you get a backup quarterback in there and receivers. Here's the difference between guys that have been playing all year, just trying to be on the same page, and you could see it for Western Kentucky there.
Up the middle goes Baker, down to the 5-yard line. With 12 seconds and counting, there's some chippiness going on after each tackle, isn't there? Which is reflective of a rivalry or a couple of teams that don't particularly care for one another, which is what we have here tonight. Quarter will come to an end with Western Kentucky poised to strike again. We go to the fourth. It's all Hilltoppers tonight in Huntington. Well, for the Marshall Band, they've not had a whole lot to play about tonight. We've heard the fight song only once tonight for these Marshall kids that came back from Thanksgiving break. They were hoping for a different type of evening on senior night, but Western Kentucky has spoiled the party. They lead 50-6 as we go to the fourth, and they are poised to strike once more. Second quarterback Tyler Ferguson is in the game. Out of the gun, lets it go, and it's deflected. And it will be fourth down and goal.
Ferguson's pass is getting it in the plate. Fourth and goal.
And we'll see the place kicker, Skylar Simcox, for the third time tonight. He's knocked home a pair of field goals this evening. This will be just a bit longer than an extra point from the right hash mark. And a thin crowd is getting thinner tonight here in Huntington. Just a 22-yarder now for the sophomore from Abingdon, Virginia. And he's 3 for 3 on the night. It extends the Hilltoppers' lead. It's 53-6. Well, bundle up on this chilly night in Huntington, Western Kentucky. Ahead 53-6 early in quarter number four. Marshall will get the ball coming up following the kickoff after the field goal by the Hilltoppers. Ranella lets it go. And Green runs it across the 20. It'll be knocked down near the 23-yard line. It's time now for tonight's game track, brought to you by Taco Bell. And that is a good-looking line score if you are a fan of Western Kentucky, and it is ugly with a capital U if you're a Marshall fan. Western Kentucky has dominated. White's had a big game with 3 touchdowns. Ace Wales, 3 touchdowns as well, and over 100 yards. It has been all Hilltoppers tonight since the opening kickoff. And Morrell making just his second collegiate start. Trying to stay warm out there tonight. How would you rate Morrell's performance this evening against a pretty good defense?
Well, I think he had a tough task ahead of him. I mean, there's 2 starts this year. Louisville, of course, playing that game and everything surrounding the Heisman hype and everything going on here. And, you know, I think he's done pretty well tonight. I mean, he's really made one bad throw, turned the football over, but he's a guy that I think they can build around.
Marshall.
Marshall calls timeout. We'll step aside here in the fourth quarter from Huntington. Early going here in the fourth quarter in Huntington, West Virginia. Marshall University with the football, and their young quarterback Morrell flushed out of the pocket. And he takes a tough hit and gets knocked down on the 25. Hey, tonight after college football on ESPN, don't miss SportsCenter at night with Bucci and Kevin Connors. They'll have a full recap from this tremendous rivalry weekend and the implications it'll have on the college football playoff rankings. Also, the NBA, NHL, NFL news, and everything else from a packed Saturday. Catch it streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN as well. Morella pitch and catch to McManus on the far side, and he's pushed out of bounds. Well, Clemson's up big on South Carolina. The story of the game nationally, clearly, earlier today, Ohio State in overtime gets Michigan. Oh, those Buckeyes found a way to win at home. It didn't look good for a while.
No. Took them overtime to get it done, but they were able to find a way to win it.
Third down and 7 on the 28, and I think they jumped offside, or were they drawn off? It is the latter.
False start. Offense, number 79. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
Well, I'll tell you, John, I've seen in person both Ohio State and Michigan in the last 3 weeks. So what is amazing about it is how young Alabama's team is. Mm-hmm. Michigan has a tremendous team, incredible skill, and a lot of veterans, seniors all over the place. Ohio State, kind of the opposite. Great skill, but one of the youngest teams around.
It's just amazing how they reload from a recruiting standpoint, one of the top recruiting classes, whether it's Michigan, Alabama, Ohio State, all three of them. And even with the young guys, they can compete.
Morrell's pass up for grabs, a jump ball of sorts, and it lands incomplete. And it'll be fourth down, and that'll force another Marshall punt. Ferris had the coverage on the play. Morrell will head to the sideline. It's going to be fun to see how this all plays out, particularly in the Big Ten as Penn State wins the East.
Yeah, how about that today? Again, another kind of a blowout victory for Penn State. And you know, they're playing their best football right now, too, so it should be interesting.
Love it. That's what makes college football great. It's been one of the most memorable months in college football. Unfortunately, it's been a forgettable night for Marshall. The punt is away and out of bounds, and we will step aside with 13-17 to play, 53-6. Time now for our championship drive update brought to you by Dr. Pepper. As we were talking about before the break, the Buckeyes, a double overtime thriller. JT Barrett getting the win, but look at UW. They're still in the hunt for a playoff spot as well. And Jalen Hurts says, roll tide. They take the Iron Bowl 30-12 over Auburn today.
UW's pretty impressive. I like what Jake Browning brings to that team.
Well, they may get another shot at SC here coming up.
Be careful what you wish for, right?
Exciting. Pac-12 has had an amazing year as well with some surprise teams with Washington State, Colorado, and, of course, what Coach Peterson has done at UW this year when they take the Apple Cup. All right, let's talk about this young man, Ferguson. He's been around, hasn't he? He's got a closet full of swag from different schools. Played at 5 games at Penn State, went to Louisville, and now he's at Western Kentucky. This guy's loading up on sweats. He lets it go down the left sideline, and that's ruled incomplete. Yeah, he played at 5 games at Penn State, by the way. It wasn't as if the kid never got on the field, and then he went to Louisville. He's a California guy, as you can see from Bakersfield. Already graduated from school, and he nearly was the starter for this Western Kentucky team.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. You know, we were talking with Brian Braum before the game and said, you know, Mike White got the job, had a great first game, but Tyler Ferguson gave him everything he wanted in spring ball and before this season started.
Third down for Ferguson. He's got a good live arm. Going to have to get rid of this one. Ooh, and he gets awkwardly yanked down. They're going to rule that an incomplete pass. He held on to that one a little bit too long. Gary Thompson from Winchester, Virginia, nearly at his 20th career sack. An awkward takedown of the quarterback, Tyler Ferguson.
Well, you could see him just rip him down, grabbing that right arm. And
Thompson shaking up on the play. He'll leave. It's ruled an incomplete pass, and it's fourth down for Western Kentucky.
And isn't that fitting for Marshall this year? And on the defensive side, Gary Thompson, his counterpart on the other side, Ryan B., out of this football game injured, and then Gary Thompson finally makes it here into the fourth quarter, and he's over on the bench now.
Here's Collins in the punt for the Hilltoppers. Kick is away. Green awaits the hit at the 30. And it'll roll to him near the 18-yard line. And he'll scoot out of bounds with 12:19 to go. And the Hilltoppers up big. Well, our Week 12 Monday Night Football matchup. Aaron Rodgers and the Packers taking on Carson Wentz and the Eagles at the Link. Our coverage begins with Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's at 6 Also streaming live on Watch ESPN. Packers and the Eagles. ...12-19 to play. That's all that stands in the way of Western Kentucky on a trip to the championship game. There's a cheesehead Marshall swag over there, right? Combination Packer-Marshall fan. Morrell, who's gone the distance tonight for the herd. Throwing on the run. He's got some room, and there he goes. And he slides down, giving himself up after scampering to the 32-yard line. It's a 15-yard pickup for Garrett Morrell. He's a baseball player, and he showed a good slide there. Nothing else.
Say, yeah, if any indication that he plays baseball, not just pitches, plays center field, shortstop, strong arm, but... You're right. That slide was as nice as I've seen all year.
Well, we've been singing the praises of Western Kentucky tonight, but Morrell, he and Litton, you figure, going into spring ball are going to be a couple of guys that are going to battle for the quarterback job for 2017 for Marshall. This was an outlying season for the Marshall team and this program. They're used to winning here. They got too many good things in place and too many good players and coaches for this to happen again. Nice flip over on that far side to McManus, and he gets ahead for about seven. Before he's knocked down over there. Is the ball free? No, the officiating crew says McManus covered it.
And the one thing about Marshall is they're not going to have to recruit a lot of players this year. They've got a lot of guys that have redshirted or some guys that have transferred. We'll see if he loses this football here at the end of this. Yeah, that ball looked like it was on the ground, but probably fell right back on top of it. But they're trying to, you know, they don't have to reload with a bunch of recruits. It's a young football team that has some guys waiting, and they can kind of shift it into higher gear quickly.
Trying to run to the far side is Pittman, and the Western Kentucky defense sideline to sideline. Good job of tracking him down. Holt, that's the son of defensive coordinator Nick Holt. There's jersey number 44. And as exciting it is for Nick to coach his kid and his kids, you know how thrilling it is for Ben to play for dad. Third down and long. And good comeback for Clark right near the sticks at about the 42-yard line. And it will be enough for the first down. Nick Holt, you talk about it. He's been at Louisville. He's been at Washington. He's been at SC. Spent 6 years in the Pac-12. Very experienced guy.
Yeah, and you asked him, his mentor out there, Pete Carroll from the Seattle Seahawks, and his staff, and the time that he spent with them at USC.
First down and 10. Uh-oh, look out. Throw to that sideline. And it's picked. Morrell's intercepted. A flag after the play. Tekorian Darden makes the interception right in front of his own bench. The flag was thrown after the play.
After the interception, personal foul. Offense, number 76. 15 yards will be added to the dead ball spot. First down, Western Kentucky.
Oh, boy. Well, that's going to give Western Kentucky even better field position. It's the second interception of the night thrown by Morrell.
Bill Legg said he wanted a quarterback that can throw it to the wide side of the field from the far hash. Well, it's asking a lot. Pretty good reaction. Take a look at defensive coordinator here, Nick Holt. An emotional guy on the sidelines. And, boy, this defense really rallies around the emotion that he has. He brings that passion every day, whether it's to the film room or to the field.
Here goes Baker popping free down the left sideline. Another explosive run for the freshman from Ashland. Kendall Gant was able to track him down. Quentin Baker does not start. He's the number two back behind Wales, but what a game Quentin Baker has had. Explosive running.
Boy, he's taken this opportunity really here and shown his ability, especially from in front of some of these Marshall fans that were hoping that they could have him
on Marshall's sideline, but 87 rushes coming into this ball game, 429 yards, and he's showing why there's a great future for him at Western Kentucky.
Well, the quarterback for Western Kentucky, Drew Eccles. He wears jersey number 4. And the injured Marshall player is Gant, who made that play defensively. So Eccles is the 3rd Western Kentucky quarterback of the night. Here goes Baker, big hole up the middle, and he's down near the 6-yard line before he's tripped up there. There is Eccles. He's from Daytona Beach, sophomore. He's going to get 9 solid minutes of playing time tonight, you think?
Yeah, he's got a little bit this year, 19 of 37, completing 51% of his passes coming into the game. And again, guy with 3 touchdowns, no interceptions on the year.
So he's the QB right in front of Baker out of the pistol, and Baker runs inside the 5. He can get a first down just shy of the 3-yard line. And he gets belted down there with 8:33 to play. Well, you got to say mission accomplished for Western Kentucky. They never let Marshall even sniff an upset here tonight. They return the opening kick for a touchdown. And then bang, bang, they score in their first 2 offensive possessions. It was 21-0 early in the first.
Yeah, they set the tone right off the top with that kickoff return. And then when they got the ball offensively, of course, going down and scoring like they typically have all year.
Baker gets stopped very near the first down marker. White's evening is done. He's traded his helmet for a Hilltopper ski cap. 233 yards and the 3 touchdowns. It's going to be 4th down and a foot for Western Kentucky.
For White now, 31 touchdown passes on the year and just 5 interceptions. He is very efficient with the football.
Well, let's see how they do in a goal line situation here with 3 tight ends in the game. And the lone back is Baker. 4th down and short. Baker will take it in for the touchdown. Goal line offense. Check that box off tonight, right?
Boy, I like what I see from Baker. His ability to make people miss and so quick. Once he makes the decision, watch him again. Watch when he sticks that left foot in the ground right there and decides he's going to go to the goal line. And he knew how close he was. He wasn't going to be denied there.
Both Baker and Wales now up over 100 yards rushing. Both Western Kentucky tailbacks have broken the century mark. And now an extra point would make it 60-6. Here is Simcox in to try to give the Hilltoppers their 60th point, which he does. Well, Marshall rarely loses at home. And they never lose this bad, gang. 60-6. Western Kentucky leads, 7:23 to play. Stay tuned. More coming up after the break. Big night for Anthony Wales and for Quinton Baker. It's the first time the Toppers have had 2 players rush for 100 yards in the same game since the Southern Miss game in 2012. Antonio Andrews and Allen did it way back then. We still have half of the 4th quarter to play, but Wales early and Baker late have dynamic for Western Kentucky. The backup kicker, Ryan Nuss, in to boot it away. Green, a yard deep in the end zone. And down at the 21-yard line. Let's go to the studio. Brandon, what you got for us, my man? It's all.
Coming up next, we have BYU and Utah State in an in-state rivalry. Kalani Sitake leading the Cougars, hopefully to an 8-win season in his first season. That's what he hopes next in Provo. Back to you.
Thanks. Well, at this stadium,
Joan Edwards Stadium, which replaced legendary Fairfield Stadium. The worst ever loss for Marshall was 4 years ago when UCF came in here and won by 37 points. My man, that record was over at halftime. It was 41-0 at halftime. It's 60-6 now. If this holds, this margin, it will be by far the worst ever whooping that the team has come in here and given Marshall. They don't lose very often here, and they've never lost like this on this field. Wildcat offense now, and there's Anthony Anderson running around the right end for a couple of yards, and he gets belted down there.
And that's part of what Doc Holliday was saying last night is, you know, the meetings that we had with them, it's, you know, after this ball game, he said, we're going to come in the next day and we're going to start evaluating. We're going to look at everything. We're going to look at our young players. We're going to look at our strength program. We're going to look at everything that we're doing here and try to figure out how we can get this thing turned around. The one thing about Doc Holliday is he is a hard worker, and he'll demand it from his staff and the players and everybody else in the organization.
Well, Marshall is fully equipped to bounce back in a big way next year. Here's a strong run by Pittman. He gets to the 35-yard line. With 6.5 to go. Well, next Sunday, we'll have a college football playoff selection show, a four-hour special to exclusively reveal the college football playoff semifinal matchups in the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl and the PlayStation Fiesta Bowl on New Year's Eve. Reese and the guys will also unveil the other New Year's Six Bowl games, and we'll have the final top 25 rankings. It starts at noon Eastern on ESPN. Also available streaming live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Here's Warren, Ohio native Pittman again, getting ahead to about the 38-yard line. It's going to be an interesting week in Seattle and an interesting week in State College and throughout Pennsylvania. And if something unforeseen were to happen, say in Orlando where Clemson faces Virginia Tech, who knows what might happen in that selection show.
What did they say? A lot of football left to play? Is that right?
There's a lot of football left to play. You know it. The score here. And here goes Pittman again, and he's knocked out of bounds just shy of the first down. And they'll put it about the 43-yard line.
Take Alabama out of this thing. Who do you think is playing the best football right now?
Who is playing the best football right now?
Yeah.
It might be the SC Trojans.
Yeah, exactly.
You got to put Ohio State in there. They beat Michigan, right? They beat Oklahoma on the road. They beat, at the time, Nebraska. By a similar score to this, it was 62-3 when Nebraska was ranked in the top 10, although the Huskers got beat again. Of course, they beat Wisconsin.
Yeah.
So if you just beat University of Michigan, I think you're playing pretty well. Direct snap, and there goes Anthony Anderson. And he'll have the first down to about the 46-yard line. I think Washington's got a great chance in the Pac-12 championship game to make another statement here.
Sure, they do. But what happens if it goes a different way and that doesn't happen? And let's say that Penn State gets beat. Then does Wisconsin? Is there still two Big Ten teams that make it?
Well, it'll be an interesting week for the committee. There's no doubt about that. Here we have 4 minutes to play. And Coach Holliday and I assume Coach Braum would just like to get this one over. They like to get back on the bus and get ready for the championship game next week. Marshall will pack it up. Pack it up for the winter.
Yeah, this is the first time since 2012 that Marshall will end their season in the month of November. And Doc Holliday certainly likes to play those bowl games down in South Florida. As you mentioned before, a great recruiting area for him, so he likes to go down there and spend some time.
3:26 to go. Speaking of November, as you know, with the win tonight, Western Kentucky will now go to 14-1 in November games over the last few years. And Coach Braum has done a great job here, but they get better as the season goes along. 14-1 in their last 15 November games. That's really remarkable. Only Florida State and Ohio State have put up 14 November wins in the last 4 years.
Yeah, this program has really
got things going, and it just has gotten better and better. I mean, this is a team that fought to get in Conference USA. They were a Sun Belt Conference team, made their way in here. Probably was the last pick to get in this conference, and now they're at the top.
Anderson on the direct snap on third down is going to get knocked down with about 2:40 to go, and the clock continues to turn. Drew Davis, he's a senior from Madison, Alabama, for Coach Brohm. Toppers will go to 9-3. They'll go for their 10th win next Saturday at 11 a.m. on their home field.
Early start.
I know.
You mentioned a bunch of high school games wrapped around it, right? And think about that from a staff standpoint. They may be hosting the volleyball tournament, too, for Conference USA.
Going to be a very, very busy weekend. And
make your reservations early, right? There's not going to be many hotel rooms left.
Here's Anthony Anderson running right on fourth down on the direct snap. And the Western Kentucky defense gets another stop with a minute 55 to go. We will step aside with under 2 minutes to play. The Hilltoppers closing in on the division title. Well, Tuesday night at 9:30, number 24 Michigan State and number 6 Duke in the ACC Big Ten Challenge from Cameron Indoor Stadium. The Duke Blue Devils and the Michigan State Spartans. Duke's 8-1 against Tom Izzo. Really remarkable. That's one of the great tournaments, or great events, I should say, the Big Ten ACC Challenge, which the ACC dominated for a long time, and now the Big Ten in recent years has come back to take the last couple. That'll be coming up next week. Just over 90 seconds left. Western Kentucky's got to snap it a couple more times here before they can claim Eastern Division champions. It'll be their sixth straight victory, and they'll lock up a spot in the conference championship game on their home field against Louisiana Tech next Saturday. 1:04 to go in our game. Coming up next, to Provo we go. Another rivalry game. Utah State visits the Cougars. Third down and one more knee for Jeff Brohm and his team. And that will do it. A long, long season comes to an end for Marshall on a long night. And for Jeff Brohm and his team, the season will continue in the championship game next Saturday on their home field.
Yeah, congratulations to Western Kentucky on a Conference East Division champions here. And for Marshall, it's just kind of get back to it and see what they can get better at as they start back at it tomorrow.
The Hilltoppers are the 2016 East Division champs in Conference USA. Once again, our final score tonight, Western Kentucky 60, Marshall 6. Now let's send it to the studio and once again rejoin Brandon Fitzgerald and Charles Arbuckle. Fellas.
Bill, thanks very much. Good job hanging in.